Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Secret of the Anointing, Accessing the Power of God to Walk in Miracles by Kathryn Krick. Narrated by Kathryn Krick. Foreword. I have studied revival figures throughout history for much of my ministry life. What does it take to carry the power and presence of God's anointing? Why did certain people emerge in the time they did to bring Christianity forward? How does one become qualified for this? These questions have driven me on a quest for a lot of my Christian life. This curiosity and pursuit has also led me to believe that in my lifetime, multitudes of Christians are being appointed and are going to rise up to deal with some of the most pressing issues of our generation, but with the anointing of God. The options we have on the table of humanity to deal with social justice, racial issues, climate and environmental issues, politics, and even some of the issues that are plaguing the church are not enough. We need God options. Options that only those who walk in intimacy with and empowerment from God can bring. I am believing that God is igniting believers all over the world to walk in His fresh anointing, to not only deal with the massive oppressions of the demonic, but also to usher in the kingdom activity that Jesus' great price on the cross is worthy of. The beautiful thing about God's secrets when it comes to moving in authority, and especially when it comes to moving in His power and anointing, is that they are all gained through Christ, and this gained knowledge is transferable. Each person who advances in their faith can ignite or impart to others. God made believers to be catalytic for one another. He made our faith to see breakthrough, deliverance, and visitation, and revival comes by hearing. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. In light of this truth, I went to see Kathryn in the park where she was holding services because I had heard some amazing reports, and even some controversial ones, and was just hungry to see what God was doing. Los Angeles was in total lockdown, and my wife and I were trying to navigate the politics of mask wearing in our city and public exposure for our family to a sickness that we didn't have a lot of information about. So I was excited to hear about a ministry that was wide open in the park while most of our friends in the city had shut down their churches and meetings. Los Angeles is one of the most cautious places on the earth when it comes to political and social norms. And I didn't know of any other church that was promising to pursue the presence of God in live meetings in Hollywood or Central LA at that time. I knew this was profound. The service hadn't started yet, and Kathryn was helping her team and being refreshingly approachable to everyone who was coming from what seemed to be some pretty far-off places. When she started preaching, the level of down-to-earth connection to her message and to the people who attended felt very special. As I watched people manifest demons and Kathryn effortlessly help them into freedom through the anointing, I knew I was witnessing something that I have been praying for more of. God had raised Kathryn up, and she was helping to raise others up. I say it was something special because I could hear in Kathryn's own messages, whether online or in her meetings, that her drive is to raise up the average Christian who really wants to walk with God into the same kind of gifts, anointing, and authority. She wasn't trying to be the only one, and there was no ego in the meeting. She was simply gracefully moving in her calling and office, imparting freedom to others, or declaring and praying that they could move in the anointing and walk in revival now. I was so excited because with all the years that I have gone out of personal hunger to investigate the miraculous and those who walk in prophetic and powerful callings, I knew this was legitimate. Kathryn has the marks of a true apostolic person, which is to activate others in the anointing. When she teaches, she makes it all seem so simple, like any of us can walk in the anointing of Christ, which is so true, but not always realized. As I write this foreword, I have to say that this book is so inclusive and practical. It dug deep into that core place in my spirit that just wants more of Jesus and to walk in His manifest reality while here on earth. If you chose this book, it's because you are hungry, or want to be, for the same. And Kathryn has laid out a very practical guide that is easy to follow and biblically based. If you pursue God to walk in His anointing, there will always be some stigma, whether that is controversy with other Christian groups, judgment from other leaders, gossip and slander from people at work or in your career or family, misunderstanding. There is a price, and that price sometimes gets amplified the more God's anointing increases on you. But I want to encourage you that no other relationship or earthly function can bring such a fulfillment as walking with the Spirit of God in His power to bring His original plans and design to His people. There isn't a drug that can make you feel so high. There isn't an earthly relational connection that can make you feel so loved. This is a unique experience that God designed all of us for, but few will actually attain it because the price is so high. Kathryn is paying that price, and because of it, she is seeing the powerful presence of God do things that are rare and miraculous. This could be your story, too. Listen to the entire book. Take notes. Ask the Holy Spirit what He is requiring of you. Picture your life with the anointing. Picture yourself moving in deliverance and miracle power. Envision yourself leading people to freedom and declaring powerful words from God. And then ask God to make you the person it will take to carry that anointing. He wants to give you more than His love and His salvation. He wants to raise you up and use your life to bring Jesus His full reward. Sean Bowles, host of The Sean Bowles Show, Exploring the Marketplace, Exploring the Prophetic, author of Wired to Hear, Translating God, Encounter, bowlesministries.com. Introduction. Revival broke out. I was on my way to revival in the park on a Sunday morning in mid-March 2021. My car was full of all our outdoor church equipment. I was about to set up for Sunday service with our team of two, Jean-Tal, our worship leader, now my assistant and best friend, plus me. I was sitting in the car talking to God, so full of expectancy that He would move in power like never before. There were four people who had informed me that they were traveling across the country, two from Nashville and two from Massachusetts, to come to Fivefold Church, or 5F Church as we call it, for our service in the park. I had been the pastor and apostle of 5F Church for about 4 years at that point. Our congregation had gone from 20 people in 2017 to 15 people in 2018 to 10 people in 2019 to sometimes just two people in 2020, Jean-Tal and me in the park, when we took services outside because we could no longer rent our building due to COVID. I had been believing in a promise from God, a prophecy spoken to me more than 4 years prior, that He would do many miracles through me and that I was called to reach the nations as an apostle of Jesus Christ. At 5F Church, we had also been believing in a prophecy released to us in 2017 that revival is now for America, and that it would begin in Los Angeles and spread across the United States and the world. But for 3 years, I didn't see many miracles happen at our church. At least I didn't see what I imagined revival to look like. And our church decreased in numbers each year. Yet, I never stopped believing in the promises of God and declaring that revival is now. I didn't have much of a following on social media up to this point either. Around 1,000 Instagram followers, a few hundred YouTube subscribers, and a few thousand TikTok followers. On December 30th, 2020, I created and posted a one-minute video on TikTok showing God moving in power the previous year at 5F Church. In 2020, I had seen Him heal Tanzanian children who had HIV and heal others who had leg pain. I saw His power touch people so mightily that they fell back. I put these miracles in the video and prayed for the viewers at the end of it. A couple of days later, on January 1st, 2021, my 30th birthday, the video reached 1 million views. I was completely shocked. Talk about a birthday surprise. And then I read the comments. There were thousands of comments, each one testifying of miracles people had received while they watched the video. Healings, deliverances, people feeling the power of God, even atheists testifying that they felt power as they watched the video. I had only seen one person testify of receiving a miracle through any of my videos online before this, and that was 2 months prior. Now there were thousands testifying after just a one-minute video? That video, and some additional videos I made, started circulating and going viral, and they reached these people in Massachusetts and Nashville. On that Sunday, in mid-March 2021, these four flew in to come to Revival in the Park. Although online there were thousands viewing my live streams, our park revival services were still small. They had increased from 5 people the first week in January 2021 to about 25 to 30 by mid-March. I couldn't believe 4 people were flying across the country to come to our church service in the park, and there were fewer than 30 of us there. I was on my way to church that day full of expectation because I knew this principle in the kingdom of God. When people are hungry and sacrifice for God, for example, by traveling across the country, God shows up. He satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Psalm 107, verse 9. I had expectancy that this would be the most powerful service we had ever had, and that we would see God move extraordinarily. But I had no idea what God was actually about to do, and how this one Sunday would change the course of my entire life. It would be the day that the walls of Jericho would come down, and the promise I had been waiting on and meditating on just about daily for 4.5 years would finally come to pass. I showed up to the park's amphitheater and found 60 people from some sort of social event gathered in our spot. We couldn't reserve it at the time because of COVID. It was just first come, first served. Although their event was wrapping up, they didn't want to move. We had never had the amphitheater taken before. On this day of all days, it was a spiritual battle to have church. I pleaded with the group, and finally they moved to the side of the amphitheater. But they still continued to blast heavy metal music and socialize just 6 feet from where I was preaching. I told those who had traveled cross-country to be there to come up to the front row, and I would preach loudly over the heavy metal music. I became even more expectant because I knew the devil was trying harder than ever to stop these hungry children of God from receiving. After the message, I started praying for one of the girls from Massachusetts. She told me, "What made me come was that when I watched one of your videos, I saw Jesus in your eyes." I started praying for this woman, and without me touching her, she fell back with the power of God. I had seen God move in that way as I had ministered before, but then I started noticing something different. Instead of lying peacefully on the ground, her body was trembling and convulsing. I immediately discerned that this was a demon trembling in her. I had never seen this when I ministered before. I had seen other ministers cast out demons, but I had never seen demons tremble in my ministry. The Holy Spirit led me to address the demon sternly, with authority, and command it to leave her. When I did, the demon spoke through her mouth, "I don't want her to preach," meaning this woman the demon was speaking out of. I commanded the demon to then stand up. The girl stood up, or the demon possessing her body stood her up, forced to obey the command because Jesus has given us authority over demons. I then commanded it to leave her. As soon as I said the words, the demon left. And the force of the demon leaving her body made her fall down, as if someone had pushed her hard. Her head fell perfectly onto one congregant's foot, and she was immediately asleep. It was just like in Luke chapter 4, verses 35 through 36. "Be quiet," Jesus said sternly. "Come out of him." Then the demon threw the man down before them all and came out without injuring him. All the people were amazed and said to each other, "What words these are! With authority and power, he gives orders to impure spirits and they come out." This was the first time I saw the anointing in me make demons tremble and be cast out. From there, it was as if the floodgates opened. Every single Sunday since that day, demons have trembled and been cast out of multitudes of people. The video of the first demon being cast out went viral, and within a couple of weeks, people were flying in from different states to encounter God and be set free at 5F Church's Revival in the Park services. From that Sunday in mid-March to Sunday, May 23rd, the church grew from 25 to 70 people. On May 30th, 300 people came. Since that Sunday, hundreds have come every week, and every single week people have flown in from different states and countries. For example, from Tahiti, Romania, Japan, the United Kingdom, Colombia, Australia, the Dominican Republic, Spain, Turkey, Mexico, Canada, the Netherlands, Malaysia, Singapore, and India. Thousands have been delivered in person at 5F Church, and also just by watching the services online. By August 2021, I was traveling every single week to different states to minister at conferences and Revival Is Now events. And many people were delivered, healed, and received many miracles at every service. In January 2022, I began traveling to different countries to minister. 10 nations in 2022, and we saw God move everywhere in His same extraordinary power. Now, people in different time zones wake up in the middle of the night to tune in to our live events and encounter Jesus. I started out not knowing that Jesus was still using people to cast out demons, heal the sick, and do signs and wonders, and not imagining that God would ever use me to do these things. Then, I went to believing that God would use me in His power, but never seeing it for years. Then, one day, I started seeing the power of God move through me in ways that shocked me daily. In this book, I'm going to share the secrets I have learned about the anointing. It is God's will for all of His children to walk in His power. It is my assignment from God to share these secrets with you, so that you are able to access the anointing as well. Revival is now, and God is ready to use you in power in ways that will shock you. Mark chapter 16, verses 17 through 18. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they will drive out demons, they will speak in new tongues, they will pick up snakes with their hands, and when they drink deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people, and they will get well. 1. What is the anointing? And it shall come to pass in that day that his burden shall be taken away from off thy shoulder, and his yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27. Have you ever wondered why you can't shake that anxiety, no matter how many times you pray and renew your mind? You've been prayed for so many times, but that sickness still remains. You surround yourself with spirit-filled people, you only listen to worship music, you read the Bible for hours, but you still experience depression and can't ever seem to feel joy. You try so hard to break that addiction. You truly don't want to do drugs, watch porn, sleep around, but it's as though a force stronger than you is forcing you to do these things. All the while, you feel consumed with guilt and shame, thinking, it's just my weakness that makes it so hard for me to change. The truth is, you need God's anointing to destroy these yokes. The anointing is the measure of God's power that He puts in a vessel. This power destroys yokes. Oxen have a yoke on their necks, which is connected to a heavy load of passengers or goods. It is a heavy burden placed upon them, and they are stuck in that yoke until someone releases them from it. In the spiritual realm, yokes are demonic oppression, or demons, that bind you. They cannot be removed through your own effort alone, such as getting counseling, taking medicine, praying, fasting, or reading the Bible. Only the anointing can destroy these yokes. Where is the anointing found? The anointing is found in human vessels. God chooses vessels to put his anointing in. All the yoke-destroying miracles we see throughout the Bible happen through human vessels. The signs and wonders that led to the yoke of slavery being destroyed off the Israelites happened through Moses. It wasn't God doing miracles from the sky. It was God doing them through Moses. Elisha's anointing was so powerful that a dead man came alive when his body touched Elisha's bones. 2 Kings chapter 13, verses 20 through 21. Paul's anointing was so extraordinary and unusual that when sick or demon-possessed people touched the handkerchiefs that had touched his skin, they would immediately be healed. Acts chapter 19, verses 11 through 12. Notice how it was a handkerchief that had specifically touched Paul, an anointed vessel, that destroyed the yokes. Peter also carried a strong anointing where demons were cast out and the sick were healed just by being near his presence and having the touch of his shadow fall on them when he passed by. Acts chapter 5, verses 14 through 16. The anointing has a location. It is found in human vessels. There is a difference between receiving the Holy Spirit at salvation and receiving the anointing. Everyone who believes in Jesus receives the Holy Spirit. But not everyone who has the Holy Spirit receives the anointing. The anointing is the Holy Spirit, but it is a specific measure of the Holy Spirit moving in power through a human vessel. When you give your life to Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes and lives in you. You can now hear from God and commune with Him. The baptism of the Holy Spirit goes beyond that. It is when the Holy Spirit comes upon you the way we see happen in the book of Acts. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Also Acts chapter 8, verses 14 through 17. Acts chapter 10, verses 44 through 47. Now you are activated and ready to walk in the power of God. Yet God has to first trust you before he can give you the measure of his power. With the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you can speak in tongues, which is communing directly with the Holy Spirit and speaking God's will, as well as edifying your spirit man, pushing your flesh down and building up your spirit. The baptism of the Holy Spirit also empowers you to live surrendered to God and fills you with fire and passion for him and his kingdom. People can still be prideful, however, even with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They can be disobedient to God and still pray in tongues. Spirit-filled people can grieve the Holy Spirit and be like the Israelites in the wilderness, wandering forever and dying before they reach the promised land of walking in anointing. Carrying the anointing is something different than just having the Holy Spirit and praying in tongues. There is a cost to the anointing. Anointing comes as God inspects your heart and finds you humble. Anointing comes when God can see that you have a heart like David's, a heart after his heart, his desires, and his will, rather than your own dreams, agenda, status, and ego. Anointing is God's true power. When misused, it can lead many away from God. When misused, it can do a lot of damage to the kingdom of God and advance the devil's kingdom. That is why God is very careful with releasing his anointing. The vessel must be trustworthy. The heart has to be right. The authority of the anointing. A yoke is a demonic chain in the spiritual realm. To remove these, you have to have the authority to remove them. You can't pray any which way. They will not be lifted unless you truly have the authority to lift them. When the disciples returned from casting out demons for the first time, Jesus said, "I have given you authority over all the power of the enemy." Luke chapter 10, verse 19. In other words, Jesus was saying, yes, this is why the demons obeyed you. This is why you were able to remove the yokes. because I have given you authority to remove those demonic yokes. I have given you authority over those demons. They must obey. What many people don't realize is that many sicknesses, disorders, and oppression, like addiction, anxiety, depression, suicidal thoughts, and night terrors, are actually demonic, meaning a demonic spirit is causing these afflictions. People try to pray the afflictions away, saying, "God, take it away. God, heal me." People take medicine and go through counseling, but the problem still remains. Maybe the problem is numbed or medicated, but deep down it is still there, because the root of the symptom is a demonic spirit. To get rid of a demonic spirit, you must have authority over that spirit and execute that authority properly. Praying any old way won't do it. You can't simply pray, "God, take it away," when Jesus told you, "I've given you authority over the demons. You cast them out by God's power in you." To cast out means to take action and authority over the demon. How spiritual authority works. Let's examine how authority works in the spirit realm. You have the choice to give God authority over your life in all situations, meaning you say yes to his will, or to give the enemy authority over your life, meaning you say yes to the devil's will. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. John chapter 10, verse 10. The way the devil is able to accomplish stealing, killing, and destroying in a person's life is when that person accepts the devil's will. When Jesus shed his blood on the cross, and even before going on the cross, he was purchasing complete abundant life for you as your inheritance. By his stripes, you are healed. Acts chapter 26, verses 17 through 18, and Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5. Healing is now your inheritance. In fact, abundant health is now your inheritance. Abundant life means abundance in every area, in your mind, in your body, in your relationships, in your finances. As Christians, we need to understand that abundant life is our inheritance. We should view lack in our life as something that cannot stay and does not belong to us, because we know what our inheritance is. We should view many sicknesses, oppression, poverty, etc., as lies of the devil. He brings you a lie and tries to get you to believe that it's the truth. For example, because you feel anxiety and the doctor has diagnosed you as having anxiety, the devil tells you that anxiety is your portion. When you accept this as your portion in reality, in the spiritual realm, what you're doing is actually accepting the devil's will in your life, which is the action of handing over your authority to the devil. Instead, you should take authority over every lie of the devil in your life. The Bible says to take every thought captive to Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. So when you're feeling anxious, you should identify that anxious thought as a lie from the devil. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. James chapter 4, verse 7. You can say aloud, "I reject that lie of anxiety or depression or rage or sickness or suicidal thoughts or nightmares." And then declare scripture aloud that speaks of God's will for your life. If you are feeling anxious, you should speak aloud from the scriptures, "God did not give me a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. I have perfect peace. Jesus has given this to me. It is my inheritance. Fear is not allowed to be in me. Any lie of fear must go." 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, and Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3. In the spiritual realm, This is the act of taking authority over the devil. God has given you authority over all the earth. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. He wants you to walk in authority by bringing his will to this earth. So you are constantly saying, "Thy will be done. King Jesus, I use the authority you've given me to bring your will to this earth and in my life." As long as you are serious about constantly taking authority over the enemy's schemes in your life, he must defer to you every time. If you've never used the authority God has given you before, it's time to start. If you take this seriously, you will see drastic transformation in your life immediately. The devil has tried hard to keep this truth hidden from believers. Many in the body of Christ today have no idea that they actually have authority over the issues the devil has brought on in their lives, and that they can access the full abundant life Jesus gives if they will just use their authority they've been given. Every believer has been given authority over the devil's attacks in his or her personal life. And every believer is given a measure of authority over the devil's work in other people's lives, depending on his or her calling and heart. Jesus said, "I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you." Luke chapter 10, verse 19. It was this authority given to the disciples that made the demons leave. The anointing God puts in a human vessel also contains authority. When demons see your anointing, they also see your authority. They see that the anointing upon you has the authority to destroy yokes. The more anointing and authority, the more demons are cast out. The higher the level of the demons cast out, such as principalities, and the quicker, with less effort, they are cast out. What makes demons leave is first when they see that anointing and authority is in a vessel. Second, when they see that the vessel knows the authority he or she has. And third, when they see that the vessel knows how to use that authority properly. Many sicknesses actually have a demonic root. Some sicknesses are actually a spirit, or demon, of infirmity. Since a demon is at the root of such sicknesses, a vessel with authority must use that authority to command the demon of infirmity to leave. Some months ago, I was in a large city ministering at a Revival Is Now event. During the mass deliverance corporate prayer at the end of service, I spoke out, "I command the spirit of infirmity to leave." A woman who had a chronic illness and who was deaf because of it immediately fell to the ground and testified that as she felt something leave her. As soon as it left, her ears opened. She was wearing hearing aids, and suddenly everything was too loud because she had regained her hearing and no longer needed them. She has since testified that she hears perfectly now. Simply saying, "I pray that you are healed," to her didn't work in that case. For that sickness to leave, there needed to be a vessel who carried authority to command the spirit of infirmity to leave. This is a major reason why we see that all sicknesses were healed in the Acts church, but today we only see some healed or few. Many in the body of Christ don't know that we have to take authority over many afflictions because they actually come from demonic roots. And casting out the demons is what makes the demons, and therefore the afflictions, go. Jesus told us to cast out demons. That's a command. That's an action. He didn't say, "Pray that the demons will leave. Pray that the Father in heaven will make the demons go." It is Jesus' power that makes the demons go, but it is our job, which he gave us to do, to take authority over the demons and cast them out. Different levels of the anointing. There are different levels of the anointing. It is God's will for every believer to carry the anointing, but the anointing in each believer will look different, according to God's perfect plan and purposes. There are also different levels of demonic powers in the spiritual realm. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. This verse is actually speaking of the different levels. For example, principalities mean princes of their spiritual territory. Principalities are the highest level of demonic power. In the same way, in the kingdom of God, there are different levels of anointing. Principalities can only be cast out with high levels of anointing. This is one reason why a person who is ministering might see some demons cast out of people when he or she prays, while other higher-level demons seem more stubborn about leaving. The spiritual insights I will share with you in this book will help you receive higher levels of anointing to deal with higher-level demons, and you will learn the solutions for seeing every person set free. The Bible clearly shows us that there are different levels of anointing. Paul was doing extraordinary miracles, which shows us that he carried a higher level, a greater anointing than most people. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and their illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. Acts chapter 19, verses 11 through 12. Also, according to this verse, he wasn't having to spend hours casting out demons. Many times, he wasn't even having to say a word to cast them out. The anointing was so strong in him that when a handkerchief that had touched Paul touched a person with demons, the demons had to leave. We also see a high level of anointing operating in the Apostle Peter. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. As a result, people brought the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and mats so that at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered also from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by impure spirits, and all of them were healed. Acts chapter 5, verses 14 through 16. Wait a second. All of them were healed? Are we hearing any church report in these days we live in that all of the sick and demon-oppressed who come to a church are healed? The Apostle Peter must have been walking in a higher level of anointing than what we see today, for the most part. If all were healed, that means even the principalities had to leave. There was an ease with Peter as well, in which the demons fled and the sick were healed. Just his shadow touching the people healed them. Like Paul, many times Peter didn't even have to say a word. People were quickly healed and set free with ease because of the higher level anointing. It is God's will for this same anointing that the apostles Peter and Paul walked in to be accessed today. Jesus made us this promise: anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works. John chapter 14, verse 12. Before he returns, the bride has to be ready. The bride has to be blameless, spotless, and pure. The body of Christ has to first look like the Acts church, and then go from glory to glory and do even greater works. Revival is now, and God is now pouring out his anointing, even the extraordinary anointing, on his church. It is God's will for every believer to walk in his anointing, and it is time now that true believers with pure, humble, childlike hearts receive and walk in it. We are in a kingdom of God. Webster defines kingdom as a politically organized community or major territorial unit having a monarchical form of government headed by a king or queen. In the kingdom of God, Jesus is king, and he has a government, the body of Christ, to which he has given authority. We bring God's will and the ideals of his kingdom to this earth as we walk in our positions of authority in the kingdom. There are different levels of authority and anointing in the kingdom of God, just as there are different positions and levels of authority in an earthly kingdom. The level of authority and anointing people receive is based on their specific calling and their heart. You must have a trustworthy heart to receive a high level of anointing. Then, it is also simply according to God's plan which level of anointing he wants to distribute for his own purposes. Those in the fivefold ministry operate in the highest level of anointing because they are the ones called to equip and impart to the body of Christ. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. Where you receive from must be greater than what you already have, and you can eventually walk in a higher level of anointing than even those who equip you and impart to you if that is God's will. We discover this in Elisha's story, as Elisha received a double portion of anointing from his spiritual father, Elijah. We are all called to heal the sick and cast out demons, but it will look different depending on your specific calling. The church is where the higher level demons are cast out and the higher level miracles happen for the most part, because that's where high levels of anointing are usually carried. People would bring the sick and demon-possessed under the Apostle Peter's shadow, who was a leader in the church, because they knew he carried such a high level of anointing that even the highest level demons had to obey. Every believer is called to walk in the anointing, but not everyone may be called to deal with principalities. In the body of Christ, the correct order for walking in authority and seeing the most effective miracles is this. Each believer is to walk in his or her own domain of authority, and also to bring people under the Apostle Peter's shadow of today, so to speak. For example, let's say you encounter someone throughout your day who is talking about having dark suicidal thoughts. If the person is open to prayer and has come to you, this is within your domain of authority. Pray for that person. Take authority over those demonic spirits in him or her. Declare that those suicidal thoughts must go. This is how our Christian life should be. Whenever you encounter the works of the devil in your domain, take authority over them and release the anointing God has given you. It will look different for every believer, but you are truly called to carry God's power. When you speak or pray, your words will carry power and bring healing and freedom. God wants you to be a vessel of his power so that people can truly meet him and have a tangible encounter with him through you. In modern times, anointing is rare. It can appear as though only a few ministers, in comparison to how many there are in the world, carry this unique anointing to walk in miracles. It was never God's will for just a couple of people to carry the anointing, however. It is his will for all believers to walk in his power. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Mark chapter 16, verses 17 through 18. All who believe, not just a few ministers with big platforms, all who believe. It is God's will for you to pray for the sick and for his power to flow through you and heal them. It is God's will for you to walk in authority and cast out demons. It is God's will for you to speak prophetically and encourage and edify the body of Christ. It is God's will for you to be a vessel that he moves through to baptize people in the Holy Spirit. Imagine how different the world would be today if every believer were a vessel of God's power. 2. Why we need the anointing. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 4 through 5. I grew up in a Christian home, and I remember first saying the sinner's prayer at 4 years old in my living room. I was sitting on the couch with my mom, and my dad was in the recliner. That's literally my earliest memory. I don't have a single memory of not believing in Jesus. In my childhood through college years, however, my faith rested on man's words and not on God's power, meaning I never had an actual encounter with God. I never felt His Spirit or witnessed a move of the Spirit. I never witnessed His power move upon people and heal or deliver them. I just believed in Jesus. But my belief was just because I believed my parents, I believed what I was taught. I believed in the Bible because I was taught to believe in it. I never doubted a day in my life the reality of Jesus or doubted the fact that He loved me and had good plans for me. But I didn't feel as if I really knew Jesus as a best friend or knew God as a father. I guess you could compare it to how children believe in Santa. It felt like that. A belief, but not a knowing. A belief in God, whom I did not personally know. Surrender based on God's power. True surrender to God happens only when you really meet Him and know Him. When you know deep down His love for you and move from a belief to a knowing. How can you devote your life to one you're not in love with? I loved Jesus, but I wasn't in love with Him because I hadn't really met Him. Therefore, I lived a lukewarm Christian life in high school and college. I knew I always felt a special love for God that was different from other people. I always went to Bible study in church, and I never missed a midweek or Sunday service in college. But I still live with one foot in the world.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.